Okay, we're here today with Takashi Mimura.
Takashi.
Mm. Mimura.
Yes.
And it is June 20th, 2016, and we're at the new Otani Hotel in Tokyo, Japan. And we're here to record the story and background of Mimura-san's career, and we're delighted to have you here. Thank you. So I see that you have provided some response to our, some written response to our questions that we had sent ahead, and I very much appreciate that. But I would like to go through that information and perhaps expand on it as we discuss for the video, okay? So, as we talk about the careers of these important engineers and scientists, we often find it helpful to learn something about their early upbringing and family environment, and what influences, or not, those might have had on their career and career direction. So, please describe for us where and when you were born, and a little bit about your family's situation in terms of your father and mother and their employment or not, and so forth.
I was born in Osaka in 1944 and grew up at Kobe. And I have two brothers. My father's occupation was designer of women's dresses, and he managed a small sewing factory.
Did either of your brothers pursue a technical career such as yourself?
No. One is a banker, and the other the tourist company.
So your mother took care of the family, is that correct?
Yeah.
Did you ever become interested or help your father in his business?
No, directly. But my father used to read passion related books, and he is acceptable. He accepted new technology. So I
So when I decided to join the engineering company Fujitsu, and he was very much glad that I selected that company.
So you grew up in the post-war time. Was it very difficult childhood, or was there?
I don't remember.
So, you went through a normal Japanese education.
Yes.
Did your father go to the university, or your mother? Had either of them attended university before? So you say in here that you actually didn't become interested in engineering until after school time. So when you were attending school, did you always intend to go to the university? Was that in your mind that you would pursue a higher education?
やっぱ小さい時はサイエンスをやろうと思って興味持ってました。
So when I was little, I was already interested in science in general.
あの私の祖母が岡山に住んでました。で、学校時代ですね、小学校とか夏休みはそこで非常に自然豊かなところで瀬戸内海で岡山っていうところですけど、そこで過ごしまして、やっぱり夏休みそういう昆虫とかですね、そういうものをまあ集めるっていうんですかね、そういうことに非常に興味を持ってました。そういうことからサイエンスをやりたいと、ナチュラルサイエンスですね。
My grandfather lived in Okayama city, and during my primary school days, every summer I went there, and I spent most of the time in collecting insects and playing with them. So I was very much interested in natural science.
I want to be a fab.
Fab.
The French.
French, the insect.
Oh.
He was a scholar who studied about insects.
I see. So you decided to go to the university. You went to Osaka?
University bachelor wa Kansei Gakuin da yo.
So the bachelor course, I went to Kansei Gakuin University. それも大阪ですか？
西宮ですね。
That is located in Nishinomiya City, close to Osaka.
And what did you study there? Did you study science there?
Yes, 物理ですね。
Physics.
And then you decided to go to graduate school as well.
大学院が大阪大学。
Yes.
そこで半導体を勉強したんですね。
I went to Osaka University graduate course, and then I studied there. I studied the semiconductor.
Okay.
Yeah, solid state
physics.
Okay. What year did you enter Osaka?
What year? 1968.
And I graduated in 1970.
With a PhD?
The master course.
Master's degree.
Master, yeah.
And did you go on to pursue a PhD at that point, or that was later?
Later.
Okay. And so you were studying metrology? Tell me what you were studying in your graduate work.
So optical characteristics of the semiconductor.
So you graduated in 1970, and what did you do at that point?
70年は卒業、富士通へ入社したんです。
And I joined the company.
You joined Fujitsu in 1970? What were your initial positions there? You said here in 1975...
Technical staff.
Technical staff?
Yeah.
And you continued work on semiconductors?
Semiconductor, yes.
Is it research? It was not product focused, or
直接製品と関係ないような研究活動。
そうですね。
Yes, research.
So tell me, what was the state of semiconductor technology and products in Fujitsu at that time? They later became very powerful in the semiconductor industry. Were they already well along? What was the focus of Fujitsu at the time in terms of semiconductors?
もちろんデジタルの LSI っていうのはあるんですけど、私が配属されたところはですね、マイクロ波の、高周出力トランジスタ、ハイパワートランジスタっていうところですね。
So, of course they had a line for digital LSI, but what I belonged to was in a microwave department that is working on the high power transistor.
Did Fujitsu at the time realize the importance of semiconductors, and were they investing heavily in that technology at that time?
Yeah. マイクロ回線を作ってましたから。
Hi. Because the company was manufacturing microwave connectivity devices,
mm-hmm.
so mm-hmm. they were very much interested.
Mm-hmm. So in 1975, you were assigned to the Fujitsu Laboratories,
yes.
based in Kawasaki.
Mm-hmm.
What was the nature of your assignment, and what was the task you were given at the time?
その当時のシリコンのトランジスタがあったんですが、それが LSI に使われてたんですが、そのシリコンのデバイスよりももっと高速のデバイス、富士通はコンピューターを作ってたんで、
はい、
別にコンピューターに使うシリコンを凌駕するような化合物半導体のトランジスタですね、
はい、
それの実用性を検討しなさいということで、ガリウムイソの MOSFET って MOSFET っていうんですけど、それの実用性を検討することが職務でした。
Back then, they were using silicon devices for their LSI.
Mm-hmm.
However, Fujitsu had a computing business unit as well,
mm-hmm.
and they needed higher performance the semiconductor,
mm-hmm.
and using gallium arsenide,
mm-hmm.
they wanted to create a compound semiconductor, and
mm-hmm.
they wanted to use that. So the MOSFET and so
mm-hmm.
on.
Mm-hmm.
And assignment for me was to study on the possibility in that area.
Mm-hmm. What were the technical roadblocks to using gallium arsenide at that time in the computing systems? What problems did you have to overcome?
ガリウムイソのモスフェットっていうのは。
So gallium arsenide MOSFET didn't work back then.
Mm-hmm.
うん、それが今回多分話のテーマになるデバイス、ヘムトっていうデバイスですけど、
mm-hmm.
それにつながってくるんですね。
So that leads to my research on a problem on the ヘムフェ
ット。Before we get to the HEMFET, can we talk a little bit about gallium arsenide?
Mm-hmm.
I know that wasn't your, but you worked a long time in that.
Mm-hmm.
So gallium arsenide was originally pursued because it had some significant
mm-hmm.
speed advantages,
yeah.
correct?
Yeah.
But it has never become a widespread technology.
Mm-hmm.
Can you tell us from your own experience what
mm-hmm.
continued to block gallium arsenide from
mm-hmm.
acceptance and use
mm-hmm.
in any kind of large scale
mm-hmm.
basis?
一番基本的にはスケーリングっていう法則はですね、使えないんです、ガリウムイソには。
So,
シリコンのモスフェットっていうのはスケーリングっていうことができるんですけど、
はい、
ガリウムイソはスケーリングっていうのはできないんですね。その当時動作してたのがガリウムイソの中でショットキーバリアを用いたトランジスタだったんですけど、それは動作するんですけど LSI にもともと向かないデバイスで、やっぱりガリウムイソの MOSFET っていうデバイスを作らないと、その MOSFET はできないんですね、解明。
So there, major or first problem about that was scaling. We couldn't apply scaling rule to gallium arsenide MOSFET. And silicon MOSFET or this, but what was used back then was Schottky barrier type of semiconductor, but it's not good for LSI. And for the purpose of the production of LSI, we definitely needed gallium arsenide MOSFET. However, we couldn't scale it.
Mm-hmm. So did you move your focus to HempFET after you realized that gallium arsenide was not a viable long-term technology, or did others continue to pursue that while you explored the HempFET option?
I had been working on gallium arsenide MOSFET for 2 years.
Mm-hmm.
それでもう問題はガリウム素という半導体とその上にその絶縁膜ゲートの絶縁膜そのインターフェース、
はい、
そこにエネルギーや順位を持ったちょっと難しいんですけど、
はい、
表面順位がたくさんできるんですね、サーフェイスステージって、でそこにそれがあると動作しないんですね。
So the problem is there is a gallium arsenide semiconductor, and we apply gate insulation on that. And there is a surface between the gallium arsenide semiconductor and the gate insulation. And there can be many different levels of surface steps. Then with these multiple surface steps, the semiconductor doesn't work.
In gallium arsenide MOSFET, to realize gallium arsenide MOSFET, we reduce the surface state density. Surface state means states, energy states,
mm-hmm.
Between gallium arsenide and the oxide.
Mm-hmm.
And when we apply the positive gate voltage, metal gate voltage, induced electron goes up to interface state,
mm-hmm.
and trapped,
mm-hmm.
and no current. So this is a very bit difficult to overcome.
Mm-hmm.
And we change the course to a new device.
Mm-hmm.
And that is him.
So Fujitsu abandoned the gallium arsenide program.
Gallium arsenide MOSFET
program. MOSFET. And did you have, so you were pursuing the need for higher frequency transistors, mm-hmm. but mm-hmm. not for computer applications, for other applications, correct?
Yeah. Yes.
So tell me, so the original driving force or customer, mm-hmm. for the gallium arsenide MOSFET was the computer division.
Mm-hmm.
Did some other division come to you and say, hey, we need a higher performance transistor? Or did you realize that need and saw that there might be a way to do that? I mean, how did, tell me about how it happened.
はい。
How you're...
どう言えばいいかな。ガリミのアンセナイドってポテンシャル、高速のポテンシャルを持ってるんですね、デバイスとしては。
ただガリマアンセナイドモスペットなんですか。
ガリマアンセナイドマティリアル自身が、はい、だからそれをデバイスにする、トランジスタにするときに問題があるんですけど。
As a material, gallium arsenide has a high frequency application potential.
は持ってるんで、だからコンピューターにとってもそれが使えれば非常にハイスピードの LSI ができるはずなんですね。
So if we can use the gallium arsenide fully, then we can create a very good the semiconductor for computing as well.
ただ、あの、それが実現されないんで、あの、困ってましたけども、ガリウムハーツなので、MOSFET 以外の、例えばさっきのショットキーって言って言葉で出ましたが、そういうタイプのトランジスタはマイクロ波に非常に適してるんですね。やっぱり高速、シリコンでは、あの、到達できないような高速の、高周波の、通信ができるとかですね、そちらにはものすごくあの世界的にですね、いろんな会社がやってましたですよね。
So the material has potential and using the Schottky、technology that I referred to earlier, that you can create an、microelectronics with the Schottky technology and、you can implementthe semiconductor for high speed and the higher frequency applications.
But not in LSI applications, but as individual amplifiers, discrete components, right? So when you decided to go in that direction, did you have a clear idea as to who the customers for that new discrete device might be, or were you just pursuing a higher frequency device, assuming that there would be needs for that?
あの、特に具体的なアプリケーションを考えてなかったですね。
I didn't think of any specific application.
とにかくそのトランジスタとして最高速のトランジスタを目指そうと。
So, we wanted to pursue an highest, the transistor for highest speed.
で、あの LSI というのは、まあ、あのトランジスタが高速だけでもダメなんですね。あのたくさんのトランジスタをこう集積インテグレートしますから、そのいろんな規制パラサイティックなですね、あの規制阻止がありまして、だから必ずしもトランジスタだけ高速にしてもそれほどアドバンテージは得られないとかですね、そういうこともありまして、あのできるだけ小規模のトランジスタを使って通信をするとかですね、そういう方面に方向を変えていったということですかね。
But LSI is more complicated.、Mm-hmm. Just the speeding up the transistor is not enough.、Mm-hmm. So it's an integrated device. So there are so many parasitic factors that we have to consider. So I changed the course or the way of thinking, and I decided to focus upon smaller transistors、mm-hmm. for specific needs.
And I understand from your paper and from here that this was not a project that the company was eager to support. Is that? Tell me about that. What, is it because there was not a clear application for it, or because they didn't believe the technology was viable?
No clear application. And, 方向を変えたところですね。あの、ガリウムイオンのモスフェットさっき言いましたけど、それは問題だったのはガリウム素の表面にそのオキサイドですね、オキサイド そのインターフェースにあのステートができると、順位ですね。でそういうものだと違う材料ですよね、ガリウム素とオキサイドっていうのは。そうじゃなくて半導体同士でそういう界面を作ってですね、その半導体の界面、半導体っていうのは結晶ですから、あのそういうステートがもうほとんどできないんですよ。そういうものを使えば、あの動作できるんじゃないのかなっていうことを、まずヒントがあります。
So as I mentioned earlier, in the case of gallium arsenide MOSFET, there's an oxide layer as well, and the interface between the two, there can be different surface levels or the surface states.
Mm-hmm.
So, however, if it's about the interface between two semiconductors. Then a semiconductor itself is made of a crystal. Then we will not have that the problem of different surface levels or surface states.
Mm-hmm.
Then I may be able to solve that problem, mm-hmm. I thought.
So you did the company give you some short amount of time or some small budget to pursue this, or did you?
Under the table research.
Under the table?
Oh, research. Under the table research. Okay.
With an official permission.
And so you did this on your own with the help of a couple of other people, or is it purely something?
Oh, yes. それアイデアを材料をまず作るそういう材料をですね結晶材料ですね成長してくれるところに相談に行ったんですね。
Yes, I did try to meet people who can grow the crystals that can be the material for my semiconductor.
で協力をしてほしいと、こういうアイデアがあるから新しいトランジスタを作ろうじゃないかっていうことで持っていたわけですよね。
And I talked about my idea, and I have this new idea, so why don't we work together to create a new semiconductor?
So you had a pretty clear idea in your head how to go about this. You thought you had something in your mind that you thought would work.
持ってました。
Yes, I had an idea.
ただそれがどこに使えるのかっていうっていうのは、例えばその結晶先お願いしたっていう、その結晶を作る装置がやはり非常に高価で、できた結晶もものすごく高いもんですよね、当然。だからコストの面から性能がいくら良くてもですね、コストの面からおそらく使うのは大変だろうなと、その当時思ってましたけど、それ以外はもうほとんど技術的にはエンジニアリング的にはもうほとんど問題なくいけるんじゃないのかなっていう自信がありましたね。
Yes, I had a very clear idea, but what was missing was just the idea for any application, because I had to go to that company or people who has capability to growpure crystal, and the equipment for the crystal growth was very expensive. So as a result, if they come up with any new pure crystal, it'll be very expensive again. And although it should be very high performance crystal or semiconductor, but it is quite costly, and I couldn't imagine who can use that in actual real world application. So engineering wise and from the viewpoint of technology, I was confident, and I thought it was a good idea, but no idea for application or who can be the user.
その時結晶成長してくれる人たちと話してたのは、たとえそのトランジスタ1個できたとしても、おそらく100万円では売れないんじゃないのかな、ぐらい、そのどういうのかな、コスト的には100万以上かかるっていう、っていう話はしてたんです。
So when I talk to the people who could grow the crystal, even if we can create a transistor, one transistor might cost 1 million yen, and who can use that? We were saying.
で実際トランジスタがもうさっきずっとこちら言いますとですね、BS 受信機に使われたんですね、家電では最もたくさん。その時にトランジスタ1個ですね、おそらく数十円でできるようになったんですね。だからそのぐらい、そのコストの面ではとてもじゃないけど信じられないぐらいですね、安くできるようになったっていうのは見込み違いだったですね。
So are the most popular application of my hemp device is BS of the satellite broadcasting receiver, and when it was used for the BS receiver, the cost of hemp was maybe the 10 yen or the dozens of yen. Mm-hmm. So the first, the price that we imagined was 1 million yen, but it became very, very cheap, very rapidly to
the, you say a few tens, like less than 100 yen.
Less than 100 yen.
Less than a dollar.
Yeah.
And so as you pursued this idea, did some people tell you to stop doing it, or did you just do it secretly, or?
全くそんなことなかったですね。やめろとは言わなかったですね。皆さん、研究所のね、上司だとか、一応こういうアイデア持ってやらせてくださいとは言うんだけど、言った時に、やっぱ面白いからぜひやってみろっていう人が多かったですね。
So no one tried to stop me, and the supervisors, my supervisors in the lab, and the people that I talked to were quite much interested in that plan, and please do that, mm-hmm. they said.
Mm-hmm. So what year, when was it that you started on this project?
79年ですね。
1979. 1979. And when in this period did you get your PhD, and how did that?
No PhD.
Okay. How long did this project take before you had a? You started in 1979.
Hmm?
You started this project in
1979。このヘムトのプロジェクトは1979年に始められて、そうです、そうです。要するに、アイデアが浮かんだのが7月頃ですね、1979年。それで、実際にものを作って動かしてみて、原理を、プロトタイプっていうんですか、それができたのが12月の末ぐらいだったですね。
So I can the inception of the idea was in July in 1979, and I tried to implement the theory, and we created the first prototype in December, by the end of
very
that
quickly,
year.
Very quickly.
So can you identify when you had this idea, or when you decided to pursue it? We in capturing these oral histories, one of the things we like to understand is, where do these ideas come from? You know, what what triggers them, or what, you know, what does it just came to you one day, or was it in a conversation with somebody, or did somebody something somebody said, or what?
集中 このガレミソのモスフェットをですね、国際学会で発表したんですね。でその 国際学会に出てきた IBM の人だったんですけど、 IBM の人と話をして、そこからなんかこういうアイデアを考えればいいのかなっていうアイデアが浮かんできたんですよね。
So I presented my research on gallium arsenide MOSFET at an international conference, and I talked to a researcher from IBM, and while I was talking with him, or after I talked to him, the idea or new direction, or I started thinking about the new direction, and the idea just came to me.
それから3週間ぐらいで、大体、どういうんですかね、アイデア、デバイスのアイデア、完成しましたですね。
And in 3 weeks, after then, I completed I sophisticated my idea about the device.
Mm-hmm. When did you publish your results? When did you make them public as the development of this device?
1980年です。1980年。
In 1980.
In June?
6月.
May.
May. So when you announced it, did you become aware of anyone else who was working on a similar technology, or anybody else who had a similar idea, or did?
あの5月に論文を発表したんですね。 今言いましたけど、
so、それで、my article in May.
6月に国際会議でコーネルだったかな発表したんですけど、その時学会で発表終わって席に着いたら後ろから肩を叩く人がいましてね、で僕と似たような相手あの論文を書きかけだったんですけど、で先を越されたって悔しがってました。
So, and in June, I went to an international conference again. Mm-hmm. I think it was at the Cornell University or somewhere. Mm-hmm. And after my presentation, I was sitting there and someone on my back tapped my shoulder. And he was trying to write on the same type of article, but I was faster. So he was very much...
French researcher.
French researcher.
Okay. That was. Once you publish your results, how long was it before people started coming to you with applications, or by the time you published it, did you then have an idea as to how it might be used or what applications it might be used in?
その時は全くなかったですね、アプリケーション。
Not yet.
それであのアプリケーションは本当偶然から生まれたんですけど、あのその3年後ぐらいですかね、アンプを作りまして、通信アンプ、通信用のアンプですね、それを僕のグループの人が発表したんです。1983年だったと思いますけど、そうすると それを売ってほしいっていう、あのアメリカの天文台 の台の関係者だったんですが、売ってほしいっていうことを言われましてね、でそういうその天文台に、電波天文台の人なんですね、そういうアプリケーションがあるんだっていうことを初めて知ったんですね。我々電波天文台っていうのはちょっとあの専門外のことだったんで分からなかったんですけども、でそういうことからあの日本でも電波天文台ありますね、あそこの野辺山に、
はい、
ですぐその後に野辺山の人からやはり欲しいと、あのぜひ使いたいんでっていうことを言われましたね。それはスタートだったですね、製品化の。
So 3 years later, maybe, my company created a telecommunication amplifier using that device. And the group who was in charge of the production of the telecommunication amplifier, they presented their work in a conference.
Mm-hmm.
And that attracted people's attention. And from the United States,one person who is related in an astronomical observatory、
mm-hmm.
Contacted our company and he wanted to use that amplifier、mm-hmm. for his observatory. And we didn't know about such the radio wave based observation system、mm-hmm. and so on, because it's totally different area、
mm-hmm.
from my specialty.And also the National Observatory in Nobeyama in Japan, the people there came to us and they also wanted to use our device、mm-hmm. in their the observatory.、Mm-hmm. And that was in 1983.
Okay. So it took some time from the time it was developed、mm-hmm. before、yeah. The application.、
Mm-hmm.
What was can you roughly say what the performance advantageof this device over existing technology? How much better? You know, was it twice as fast, 100 times as fast? What was the...?
Noise is very important criteria.
Okay.
And noise が非常に低かったっていうのと、それまでのデバイスっていうのはやはり振動、非常に長時間観測しないといけないんですね。電波天文の場合は。1週間ずっと観測し続けると。その間その素子の安定性ですね、でそれまで のデバイスっていうのは振動が起こったりしますとね、特性が動くんですよね、不安定になるんですね、そういうことがなかったっていう点で低雑音が一つと、そういう素子の安定性っていうのが、
So low noise characteristic is very important for such device, and our device had very, very low noise level. And also in the case of the radio wave, the astronomical observatory, they needed to continue the monitoring for a week or so. The device stability becomes very important because the vibration or oscillation occurs, and you have to stay in the same state. And the vibration characteristic was also very good in our case.
So when you were developing it, it sounded like performance was the major goal in terms of higher speed device. Were you also aware of the low noise or stability capability? I mean, did you recognize those as important characteristics?
そう思いますね。それで、
もともとそのハイスピードのデバイスということでのパフォーマンスを上げていくのを目標に開発をなさったと思うんですけど、
そうなんです。
当初からその低ノイズ性とか、その振動耐性っていうのも重要な特性になるとは考えていらっしゃる。
考えてなかったで。それで、ノイズはね、高速性であればだいたいノイズは下がるんです。高速デバイスであるあればあるほど低雑音なんですね。
So noise level or low noise characteristics is that comes with the high speed. So if you can create a very high speed device, then the noise level goes down.
But speed was the thing that you were most that you thought was most interesting. Most valuable.
And それで観測する周波数帯が20何ギガ、結構高周波なんですね。それも非常に重要なポイントですね。
And also high frequency. Yeah, high frequency spectrum is required for such observation. So what they are using was 20x gigahertz.
They needed speed, they needed performance and noise and stability. So did you continue to refine that device, and once you found an application, did you then sort of pass it off to others in terms of manufacturing? Did you continue to do research in that area to refine and improve it? What did you do following that time, 1980?
研究所、その当時はもう1985年にさっきの何でしたっけ、電波天文のアプリケーションが完成しましてですね、それからは87年頃が BS ですね、 BS アンテナに使うと。で2年後にヨーロッパの、ベルリンの壁は壊れるんですけど、それはヘムトを使ったおかげでアンテナがものすごく小さくできたと、半分ぐらいに。それで東ドイツの、東ベルリンの人も各家庭に持てるようになって、外から見られなくてですね、どういうんですか、西側の放送機が入るようになったんですね。でそのために非常にやはり自由で豊かな西側に憧れてっていうのが基本的にはモチベーションになったんだと思いますけど、それは87年頃から BS 用のアンテナの輸出がですね、ものすごく活発になっていましたですね。
So in 1985, our device was finally implemented in the observatory, and around in 1987, it was used for BS antennas, and it contributed to making BS antenna in a smaller form factor, and because we the use of HEMT, you can make antenna very small, and it led to the fall of Berlin Wall, because the East Berlin citizens could watch the TV program from the West very secretly because the antenna was so small. Then they knew about how rich their life in the West was, and it led to the fall of the Barren War. その前にですね、彼の質問
が、ちょっと答えなかったなと思った。
で、あのヘムトを完成されて、そしてそのアプリケーションが見つかったわけですけれども、その後もそのヘムトについてより洗練を深めるための研究を続けられましたか。
はいはい。あの例えば今までの話は大体半導体の材料としてはガリウムアーセナイドを使ったんですけど、さらにあの高性能化を目指すためにインジウムフォスファイドっていうインジウムリンですね、そういう材料を変えるとか、でもっと最近ではガリウムナイトライド、あのこれはあの青色 LED の材料と同じなんですけど、それを使うことによって非常にこうハイパワーですね、今の携帯電話の基地局にはほとんどガリウムナイトライドのヘムトが使われている、もうそういうふうに徐々にその材料を使う材料によっていろんなアプリケーションにあの適用できるようになっていってますですね。
So I kept working on hemt, the widening the selection of materials.So originally it was made of gallium arsenide, but to seek or to pursue a higher performance, we started using indium phosphide and the gallium nitride, that is a material for blue LED.
So did other companies pick up this technology or license this technology from Fujitsu?Or is Fujitsu the only source of?
今現在のことを言えばですね、あの富士通は外には売ってないです。
So talking about the about now, we are not selling hemp to any other companies outside the group.
あの富士通が作っ工場もあったんですけど、あのそういうヘムトを作る工場もあったんです。それはあのスピンアウトして、別の会社になりました。
So back then we had a factory that could produce hemp. However, we spin it out and it became an independent company.
Oh, I see. So Fujitsu is the only source of hemp devices. Is that?
ヘムトデバイスをあの提供なさっていた会社というのはもう富士通だった。
あのアメリカの会社もそうですし。
U.S. companies.
あの。
So yes or
no?
No.
There are other companies.
There are other companies. So did they? Did the? I mean, you have a patent on the device, yes?
ヘムトデバイスに関してはパテントをお持ちでいらっしゃるん
ですか？もう切れてます、特に。
It expired.
It expired. Okay.
Many years ago.
Right. Okay. So you are still doing research today, is that correct?
Yeah.
What technologies have you pursued since your work on the hemp, or have you continued to refine that technology?
今難しいね。
That's difficult.
あのやっぱり興味持ってることは持ってます。あの特にですね、あのこれからはやっぱり、エネルギー省エネですね、
はい、
をするためにガリムナイトライドのテクノロジー、ガリムナイトライドのヘムトっていうのがやっぱりそのキーデバイスになると思ってまして、その辺のパフォーマンスを上げるとかいうことが非常に求められてますね。
So, I'm always interested in the improvement of hemp and for more energy savings. the greater expectations on the gallium nitride. So I think it has a very much potential to save energy.
So in this last section, we asked people what are some of the newer technologies or new ideas that if you were entering the university or leaving the university today, what areas sort of catch your attention as being ones that you might pursue if you were to be starting your career today?
そうですね。これの5番のね。昨今の技術開発どう思われますかとかいうのもありますけど。
Under this, it is numbered as five. Question number five in Japanese script about, and in the second bullet point, you're asking about how do I think about the technology development these days.
これはやっぱりね、今どういうのかな。競争が厳しすぎるっていうのかな、それ長期にわたる展望がなかなか持ちづらいっていうのが現状としてあるんじゃないのかなっていうことで。
So currently this industry is too much competitive and it's very hard to have a long-term vision.
そういうのは非常にちょっと危惧してます。
So that's I'm worried about.
Everything is short-term focused.
Yeah, short-term. So the 4番はやっぱりやっぱりサイエンスとエンジニアリングっていうのを融合した分野がどうも好きみたいなんですよ、僕自身。
And about your original question, being a college student now, it seems to me that I'm more interested in the fusion type of area of the merger of science and engineering.
そういう意味で、そういう面からですね、やっぱり医療だとか脳科学ですね、ブレインサイエンスとか、メディカルサイエンスとか。
So medicine, medical science, or brain science?
そういう方向がなんか、やるのか、やってたのかな、やりたいかなっていう。
So if I were a student right now, I might be interested in that kind of areas.
Do you have children?
Yes, two.
Have they pursued anything in the technical area or?
One is a medical doctor. And one is a wife.
Hardest job of all. Is there anything that you would like to tell us about your career or your life that we have not discussed at this point?
Yeah, 特にないですね。
Nothing special.
Well, I think it's always very interesting to talk with people such as yourself who have come up with brand new ideas and that other people are not pursuing, and how did those happen and what was the environment, and because we're always looking for ways to make continuing advancements and to understand the context and environment and ways in which things have happened in the past are important lessons for the future. So we appreciate, compliment you on your significant breakthrough and your ongoing contributions, and also for spending the afternoon with us to tell us your story. Thank you very much.
Thank you.